Hi, everyone, and welcome to Mindtree's Possibilities Forum, Sustainable, Scalable, and Successful Healthcare Through Digital. I'm your host, Sarah Jeckman. Before we begin the presentation, I have a few housekeeping notes for you. You are currently in listen-only mode. If you experience any technical difficulties during the webinar, click on Help or send us a chat in the webinar console. This is an interactive session, so feel free to type your questions into the question box on your console, and we'll do our best to answer as many questions as we can at the end of the session. I'd also like to mention that today's presentation will be recorded and available for future playback. We'll also be conducting a few polls during the webinar and would love your participation. All polls are anonymous, and you may see the results pop up in our future marketing initiatives. And lastly, we'd love to hear from you on social, so feel free to tweet us at Mindtree or LTD, or use the hashtag Possibilities Forum. We've got a great program lined up for you today. We'll begin with a quick intro of our panelists, then Abhishek from the Everest Group will share perspectives and set the stage for the session, followed by the discussion with our panelists, and finally, we'll open it up for audience questions. Now, I'd like to pass it over to Ganesh Nathella, head of Mindtree's Health Business Unit. Over to you, Ganesh.
Good morning, everyone. We know that digital solutions have reshaped and will continue to transform the member engagement, patient engagement, and transform care delivery, disease diagnostics, and treatment. And digital transformation was a top priority for the industry prior to COVID. However, the pandemic has further accelerated the adoption of digital health, and we see this happening in real time with use of virtual health and with the use of personal devices to access care, social determinants of health, and many more. We will hear soon from the eminent leaders across the health ecosystem who are not only transforming it in the industry, but also doing so many things to move the needles within their own organization. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce the panel members. Chris of Virgin Pulse, and Chris Michelak brings more than a decade of healthcare, technology, and industry leadership and experience to his role at Virgin Pulse. A purpose-driven healthcare, technology, and services leader, his expertise spans strategy, corporate development, operations, and talent development. He has deep knowledge of the rapidly evolving healthcare market and has successfully led software-enabled services businesses before Virgin. At Virgin Pulse, as the CEO of Virgin Pulse, Chris is responsible for leading the company's global growth strategy and helping clients unlock the full value of their healthcare investments to drive better health outcomes. The second panelist is Tony Ambrosier. He is the Chief Information and Digital Officer of Baptist Health South Florida. Tony is a proven leader in the technology and digital space with a keen focus on using technology to enhance the consumer experience. Under his leadership, the company is revolutionizing how patients seek and receive care, as well as how clinicians can deliver the care. He is driving ongoing initiatives to improve consumer access and put actionable data at the fingerprints of decision makers. He's also utilization of telemedicine and IoT and the application of ML to improve quality and efficiency. In his prior role as the Vice President, Technology and Digital Leader at Walt Disney Company, he was responsible for digital and core systems and technologies, engineering, data analytics, and machine learning for Disney Parks, the consumer products, games, and publishing. Now, going to the third panelist, David Shapiro. He is the SVP of Consumer Provider Experience and Communication at United Healthcare. And David is putting customers at the forefront and walking a mile, more than a mile, I would rather say, in their shoes is a philosophy that he deeply espoused. He's also responsible for developing and implementing an integrated strategy, measurements, and coordination across all the functions to drive consistency in how UOG serves members. He works very collaboratively across all touch points provides strategic direction, helps the organization understand the needs of Medicare beneficiary to create a member-centric culture. And our last panelist is Asif Mujahide. He is the VP of Enterprise Data and Analytics at Blue Cross Blue Shield of Minnesota. And Asif, as a Vice President of Enterprise and Data Analytics, leads the Enterprise Data and Analytics unit at BCBS Minnesota. And he brings with him more than 15 years of experience leading and managing data and analytics teams across various industries. His focus is on analytic capabilities that facilitates better program performance, evaluation, and development, which aids in decision-making for employers and facilitates value-based care, improve affordability of care, and creates better experiences for members. I thank the panelists for being here today. And myself, I am Ganesh Nathalla. I head the business for Mindtree, and I'm based out of Chicago. Abhishek, please go ahead and introduce yourself and get started with your session.
Thank you, Ganesh. Hello, everyone. My name is Abhishek Singh. I'm a partner with Everest Group. We are a research firm that focuses on technology, data, and analysis. Here at Everest Group, I lead our healthcare technology research. So if you have a question whether a vegan diet will help you achieve scalable, sustainable healthcare, I'm not the right person. But if you have a question around, hey, what are the insights or benchmarks that you need to move healthcare records onto public cloud? Call me. So on that note, today my role will be slightly different. So instead of answering questions, I will be asking them. And since Ganesh did such an amazing job of introducing our esteemed panelists, my role is probably very easy here, just to pose some of the questions to the practitioners that you have just been introduced to. So let's move on to the next slide, because no discussion on healthcare can happen without paying homage to the biggest challenge at hand, which is affordability of care. In fact, I'm immediately reminded of a joke that somebody told me years back. It was about a person who calls up his insurance company asking, hey, who is the most affordable doctor in my area? Back came the reply, Dr. Pepper. Yeah, so this is the kind of environment where we live in, wherein we can probably joke a bit about what's really happening with the cost of healthcare, but we all know and understand, looking at this picture right in front of you, that it is indeed a complex environment in which healthcare works. And hence, any discussion around sustainability and scalability will also have to be looked at from the perspective of how healthcare gets delivered, what are the different aspects of the services, but also what lies behind it, like what underlies the medical costs, what underlies the administrative and other operational aspects of healthcare. And that's what we will touch upon and go beyond that today. Moving on to the next slide. As you can see, the healthcare as such is kind of transforming to a new era. And we have seen and heard this term before also, but let me put things into perspective before we dive into the questions. When it comes to healthcare enterprises, there is a kind of a dichotomy between the old and the new that is happening right now in front of us. Most healthcare organizations, and we'll hear it from our esteemed panelists today, are trying to build what we like to call a digital front door, through which patients, or I would like to use the word customers also, because patients typically ends up indicating there is a morbid health situation that is there in place, but a customer probably thinks of healthcare irrespective of whether or not there is a healthcare situation. So what we indeed have in front of ourselves is healthcare organizations who are trying to pivot from one size fits all kind of cookie cutter approach to build solutions or experience models which are customized and tailored to individuals out there. when it comes to aspects such as reimbursements, data systems, business models, we are already seeing this dichotomy of the past and the future playing out in many different ways. Now, this slide in many ways tries to oversimplify things, but our experts here know that how complex and fragmented some of these approaches can be. And for each of these, there has to be a specific roadmap or a journey that you need to build. On that note, moving to the next slide. When we talk about digital front door, in many ways, we end up spending huge amount of time focusing just on the interfaces being created. And at the same time, we might end up forgetting that there is an underlying engine on the mid and back office side, which is the digital for efficiency or digital for enablement, ranging from anywhere things such as claims or revenue cycle management to security, compliance, and regulations, which might not be visible directly to patients, but are critical to delivering the experience aspect that we are talking about. And hence, this is the key takeaway for you as we start off on this discussion, is that no digital front door strategy can succeed unless and until you get the digital plumbing, which is the kind of the black box behind the experience interfaces that you interact with. Next slide. And hence, today, this panel discussion will focus on three aspects or the three critical issues that we will try and deal with in nuances, which is one, hey, how can we use data for better healthcare outcomes to support decision making? How can we drive better healthcare experiences? And we have all heard this term, value-based healthcare. How can we continue to increase focus on that and build, make it more metric-based so as to actually achieve outcomes on this topic? So with that as the background, Chris, I'm going to come to you with the first question. Chris, you have a rich experience in helping organizations deal with the question of employee benefits and well-being. In your opinion, what should be the moonshot for organizations who are listening to us today as they look at their own healthcare benefits redesign?
Yeah, I spend most of my time with employer-based companies that are self-insured. So companies that are, you know, bearing a fair amount of the risk for the healthcare that they're providing to their populations. Virgin Pulse is in the middle of trying to be the front door for, as you just described, for those members to help them navigate the complexity of the healthcare experience. So as I think about that question, the first thing that, you know, comes to mind is I think the redesign of healthcare benefits should start actually with the member in enabling the member to make better decisions about healthcare each and every day. So, you know, from my perspective, that means a high-tech platform or a set of technologies that are created to be simple to use, a good user experience, comprehensive in their approach, something that enables the user to have access to all of the tools and resources that a company's providing to that individual. Today, there is a proliferation of point solutions dealing with every independent possible chronic care condition, as well as a number of other point solutions to help people to manage their healthcare more effectively. But very few people are providing a comprehensive place or single front door to access all of those capabilities. So the first thing is, I think the digital challenge is to, you know, have an integrated, easy to use user experience that puts that at their fingertips. But the second thing that I think is important, I think you need a high touch capability as well. It's my perspective that healthcare decisions for people are complex. And when they're in a particular moment that matters with respect to their care or the care of their family, having somebody to reach out to can be really important. Or if you're in the middle of an ongoing chronic care condition, that help that you can get from an individual coach or somebody who supports you in that regard is really critical to outcomes. So I think high tech and high touch are both important in this scenario. And it's my belief that when people are engaged at a high level, when they're involved in that technology, involved in those high touch services, they're in a better position to make better decisions regarding healthcare, which will lead to better outcomes for them individually, as well as for the plan as a whole. And so from my perspective, the moonshot is, you know, do we design our solutions and our plans and our approach and our technology to engage consumers who are driving a lot of that cost in the right way?
Got it. So I just wanted to nuance that a bit further for our audiences. Could you help identify any outcome parameters that you have seen organizations pivot to that have made their approach towards benefit design more successful?
You know, it's interesting. I have historically over the last several years always said that the employer, you know, self-insured employer really cares about two things: making the experience better for the individual and then lowering the overall cost of care. But I've been in a handful of discussions in the last couple of months with heads of HR or heads of benefits, and increasingly part of the story that I'm hearing from them is they care about, they're coming off of COVID, from my perspective, changing their perspective from a more narrow view on cost to a more broad view on productivity, presenteeism, engagement of their people in their companies. And I know that those are more macro metrics, but you know, I've spent a lot of time with a handful of Fortune 50 companies, and the challenge in our environment with the great resignation and the challenges that have come out of a COVID environment is, how do I keep people here physically because I'm keeping them healthy or in the best health I can provide, mentally with mental health issues that they're facing, and emotionally they're engaged in the company and care about what the company is doing. To me, the macro measurement of success is, are you doing those things well, and are you winning in this employment environment that's become increasingly difficult over the last, you know, handful of months?
Indeed. Any best-in-class examples that you might want to share here?
Well, I've worked with a handful of clients. I talk about, you know, one particular tech company. They're using a set of personalization capabilities. They're using a front door, a technology front door, and a set of high touch coaches, as I described earlier. And all of these things were designed specifically to touch members in a way that affected outcomes in a really positive way. Are we getting them to the right doctor? Are we getting them to the right facility? Are we getting them to the right procedure? Are they following the program? Are we closing gaps in care? I think when you're addressing all of those aspects, leveraging high tech and high touch platform, I think that's when you get to the outcomes that you're really looking for.
Indeed. Wow. This is indeed a great way to tee off this discussion. So Tony, I'm coming to you because now the topic is shifting towards how things even such as patient experience, which most people consider as an abstract topic, could also be very much metric driven. And we all know that it is a topic which is core to the healthcare outcomes debate. And Tony, you have worked at Disney, and you probably have your own experiences as a consumer of healthcare. So combining both, what is the playbook that you are using to drive success?
Sure. I would start by saying I don't think there's anything abstract about customer, consumer, or patient experience. I think consumers and patients, and we can talk about the difference in a moment, are looking at the quality of their experience, especially the digital experience. Keep the medical experience aside. This is not a conversation about that. But they're looking at their digital experience as a critical factor in choosing healthcare providers, especially for the lower half of the acuity scale. And that's the case for a number of reasons. First, we extrapolate their day-to-day digital experience with Amazon and Apple and the banks and travel companies and Virgin Pulse and onto healthcare, and the expectations are high. And frankly, there is no reason for their expectations not to be high. Would you want to order from Amazon if you had to wait for 30 minutes for an agent on the phone? No, you wouldn't, right? So why would you want to do that with a healthcare provider? I think second, the competition to the traditional providers is intensifying, and it's coming from new entrants, not necessarily the big tech, but clearly Amazon is one, CVS Health is another, even Walmart. They do have polished and comprehensive digital experiences, and compared to the traditional systems, the provider system. So why would you go somewhere where it's hard to get into and hard to deal with when you can go elsewhere where it's easy, all other things being considered? And third, a poor consumer and patient experience is the last thing you need when you have a medical problem, frankly. If all the mechanics and the logistics is simple, convenient, and useful and supportive, then you can focus on, as a patient, on the health versus fighting the system. So I think there are a few important rules to accomplish that. First, we must consider the entire customer and patient journey, and not just some disconnected parts or episodes. Otherwise, it's like a cellular mobile service that has lots of no coverage zones, which is pretty useless. Then I would say, second, relentlessly focusing on usability and on the details, relentlessly. Always maniacally focusing or thinking from the consumer and patient perspective, and not necessarily that of a provider perspective. And finally, make sure the experience works very well. It's fast, and the apps or the websites, whatever the tools are, work well, and then don't crash. Nobody cares for 14 toes. Now, you mentioned metrics and measuring. Absolutely, that's how you tune the experience, or one tunes the experience all the time, tracking how well things work, how much adoption there is, and what channels are preferred versus another. Absolutely, and I think we've solved these problems a long time ago, frankly, in the digital experiences. I think you mentioned other aspects. I would talk about data insights and predictions and recommendations. That's important, and there are multiple aspects, but I'll focus on two. First, apply it very smartly. This is the data and analytics, as Disney does. It can really enhance and smarten the experience of the consumers. Simply by eliminating the noise and providing in place at that time experiences. And that was mentioned earlier, I think it has a tremendous tremendous opportunities to improve the efficiency of operations, reducing costs. You're talking about affordability. That's a big problem. But at the same time, also improving the patient experience related to that.
Indeed. Thank you. In fact, you almost preempted the second question that I would have had around data, and thank you for answering that. Which brings me to David. Now, David, you just heard Tony talk about his experience working with data and how the experience aspect plays out in his role as a leader at a provider organization. And personally, I would love to see a Disney-like experience happening with healthcare, although people don't go into hospitals or interact with peers to get any sort of a Disney-like experience, but we still, people do care for it. And it's almost like a hygiene aspect these days. Now, David, you have dealt with the question of customer experience in healthcare for close to 16 years. That's quite a long time. What has changed in your experience? I mean, industry, as you have observed it broadly, or United Health in particular, in healthcare organizations' ability to deliver on the outcomes related to patient experience?
First, I just thanks Abhishek and Ganesh for inviting me today. And for those that live in the CX customer experience world, happy CX Day, which was yesterday, or Customer Service Week, which is happening all this week across the country. It's just great to see this discipline, and especially in healthcare, because to your exact point, 15 years ago, I joke with people at my organization. I think I was the first one to be hired with a title of experience, and I continue to survive the healthcare space, and there's so much opportunity in front of us in so many ways. I mean, I think 15 years ago, I think specifically, and healthcare is broad, so I'll specifically talk about it in the space that I'm in, the payer insurance space. 15 years ago, I think people would consider us a B2B business, working with employer groups. And that was a lot of focus. And obviously, in the Medicare, Medicaid space, stuff started to grow. The introduction of Part D, which was almost exactly 15 years ago, I'd say, into the Medicare space, became this, and I actually, was first introduced into our world, specifically in the Medicare. That is a B2C business. At that point, you lose a member, you gain a member, one at a time. It was the one, it's the one space where you actually had, I call it some capabilities, some marketing, some data, needs, because, well, if you need to acquire, Medicare, members, you need to know, who they were at individual levels and engage them in meaningful ways. And I think that's, when I think about, where I feel like healthcare really started to enter the B2C, in the B2C space, I think it's always been there, but it really, I feel like, took a new lens, probably some of with the Affordable Care Act and some of what in Medicare space did with STARS. It really started to align, incentives for all parties involved in the healthcare ecosystem. And that to me was a moment to say, hey, it's a win-win for everybody, for members, for organizations, for physicians, for healthcare systems, let's make sure that our members, let's engage them and make sure that they've got their colonoscopy, that they've got their mammography, that they're adhering to their medications, that they're, and how do we start to bring all that data and information together in a really meaningful way to have meaningful conversations to help them live healthier lives. And I've seen that, sort of that mindset just bleed in to all other aspects of the organization. Obviously, consumerism just in general, based on what's around our everyday worlds, is becoming more and more important. Our people are having higher expectations because of what they're experiencing in every other industry. So obviously it's becoming more important in so many ways. I feel like we are really sort of, the last few years, it's just been great to see, the transition of it, getting every part of the healthcare ecosystem to really focus, and I do a lot on the provider experience side too. There was a day where it's like, I wondered, hey, that's a really critical part to the healthcare ecosystem. We need to make sure that we've, we're leveraging the data and we're integrating data between consumers and providers to create great experiences and connect the healthcare ecosystem. So it's been a journey, but in the early days, it was hard for me to get a few dollars to go get some research on consumers. So I feel a lot better today.
Indeed. Thank you, David. In fact, one interesting anecdote that you shared was that this whole B2B to B2C shift, the turning point in many ways was the ACA or STARS. Now, if you look at the next 5 years, what do you think will be the key vehicle for change here in terms of the next turning point? Will it be the regulations, anything that you're noticing on the technology or data innovation side, industry collaborations or consortia? What do you think where the next wave of change will come from?
Specifically, maybe I'll touch on two of those. Regulations, I think I'm very bullish on some of the transparency rules, what CMS has, Centers for Medicare and Medicaid have started to, demand, starting here in January of 2022 and moving forward. I the number one, NPS, challenge for, my members, it's a close tie between access and cost, but cost is always at the very top. And this was already discussed. Your first slide starts right there on affordability that you shared today. And so, as this cost data, becomes more prevalent, I just fundamentally believe, we're going to start to put the decisions, we're going to start to consumerize healthcare like every other industry. I mean, it's crazy that you don't know the cost of when you walk into a provider's office or, and it's complex. And don't get me wrong, there's a lot of reasons why, the system, is the way it is today. But as soon as all that data is shared and technology takes advantage of that data and people have data at their fingertips to realize that decisions that they're making every day between going to one drugstore versus another, going get an MRI versus one place versus another, when they've got high deductible plans and they're making critical decisions, they're going to want that data at their fingertips because that's for much of the country, those are some critical decisions of making decisions about their household and everyday living, putting food on their table and their healthcare, and we've got to enable people with that data. So I think the transparency rules, I'm very bullish on. The other one, you touched on this one as well. I mean, I think your second slide is just interoperability. I just think it's, as data starts to get shared more broadly, as even some of the regulations comes in, as making data shared more broadly, the fact of the matter is we're just going to have data. It gets to this point of consumerizing data again. Data is going to be at people's fingertips. The day of me trying to figure out when my last tetanus shot was should no longer exist. I recently went and I had to ask for a disc for a scan. Those days should be on my phone. Medical records should be extremely transparent. Tony shouldn't have to ask for medical records. These people, we shouldn't have to ask for it six times. We should ask for, if at all, once. so we've got to, I think that interoperability and sharing of data is just gonna, open up the world in better experiences for all.
Super. In fact, this creates an interesting and nice segue into the topic of value within healthcare. And Asif, I'm going to come to you. And I know you have seen how the discussion has built up so far. And since we were talking about metrics, we were talking about outcomes, the one adage that I rely on when I speak of outcomes is you cannot drive outcomes on things that you cannot accurately measure. And this has been the issue that personally I have seen with value-based contracting also. Now, you deal with this on a day-to-day basis. Now, my question to you is, how can healthcare drive consensus between payers and providers so that they can agree on and measure the metrics that actually help healthcare drive towards value-driven outcomes?
Well, thank you, Abhishek, for the question. And Ganesh, Abhishek, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak over here. And I just wanted to start off by saying it's a really interesting question. And if we had the answer, we would have figured it out by now over here. So the consensus piece, it's an important one. So I want to start off by saying that, when it comes to value-based contracts, obviously, really important to have that in place if the end goal for us is total cost of care. And, everybody's impacting, the consumer over here in different ways. There's a big part that the provider has to play in that, Now, that being said, as we know that over the course of the past few years, the rate at which VBC adoption was anticipated has not happened. And that gets to the crux of, the question that you're asking, in my opinion, over here, Abhishek, is that we still haven't reached that consensus point as to, okay, what are the metrics that matter? And it's not that we don't know what those are, it's getting to that consensus phase over here. A couple of things I wanted to say over here, in terms of guiding principles, at least in my experience I've seen when I've gotten into these conversations, is you've got to make sure that the metrics are really meaningful. And nothing surprising in there, but it's an important statement to make, because the phrase meaningful means different things to different people, or different stakeholders within the value chain. You've got the payer, you've got the provider, you've got the consumer, you've got the regulatory, et cetera, and host of other players, that factor into the mix over here. And at times, the practical reality of the matter is that at times, there is overlap with consensus in terms of, the metrics and outcomes, but at times there is not. And a lot of that is, in my opinion, by the incentive structure, that is in place in healthcare, where once again, at times, there is consensus on the incentive structure, but at times there is conflict, when it comes to the how incentives flow. Now, that being said, in my experience, there are four ways, I've seen where, we reach, that point where, there is good collaboration, good consensus, especially when it comes between payers and providers. And I'll spell those out, what those four are. Number one is to ensure that you have the right operating model, you know, at play between payer and provider, and very tactically having the right people at the table and the right people early on. Because, you know, when contractual negotiations happen between payer and provider, sometimes, you know, the analytics functions are not at the table, et cetera. Just making sure, you know, you're doing your due deliberation around that and being deliberate around the operating model that is structured when these conversations happen. The second thing I would say is to focus on heuristics and hypotheses. And, you know, that I know that's a fancy term, and here's what it means, you know, from my side, is being very clear, you know, along with, in this case, providers, as to what is the problem statement, you know, you're trying to solve for. In essence, putting yourself in the provider's shoes and saying that, okay, if I had this metric, this XYZ metric, I could really make a meaningful impact in the populations of the patients that I serve. And being very clear and precise on that, because, you know, I mean, we may have differing opinions. The payer may have a different opinion on what that metric should be. The provider could have a differing opinion. So reaching that agreement, you know, with the provider at the table. The third piece I found, which has been helpful, you know, to gain consensus when it comes to outcomes, is what I refer to as to create a play place. A play place for, you know, sort of iteration, being agile, you know, with the provider groups that you're partnering with. Very tactically, you know, from my side, you know, I've seen conversations happen, and those are meaningful conversations. We reach consensus, but we don't talk, you know, for the next 30 days, and everybody forgets, you know, what we all agreed to. So having this place, you know, where you can iterate jointly, you know, with your providers and your provider groups, and simulate your way, you know, through, you know, what those actual metrics would be, you know, has been really helpful. And I did want to say, you know, when I use the word simulate, it maybe was a Star Wars term in 2005. It shouldn't faze anybody today. You know, I mean, we're all doing simulations, you know, so the world has progressed. And the fourth and final thing I'll say is that making it all happen. And this is where the rubber meets the road, that, you know, you can agree, you can have the right operating model, you can agree on the heuristics and all of those things, but you've got to make sure that information is delivered to the, in this case, the provider, you know, at the right time, the right provider at the right time, so they can make meaningful actions with the patients and consumers that they're seeing, which will then have a positive externality on the population when you look at it from a client level. And that's where it gets very tactical, monthly, quarterly, annual insights, you know, and the exact metrics that you need to deliver, and taking care of quality and validity of that information. And the final thing I'll say over here, you know, just, I guess, just for the audience, and once again, this is more an opinion from my side, but, you know, just to put a finer point on it, you know, when it comes to VBC contracts, some of the outcomes and metrics, you know, that generally speaking, you know, have been really impactful are, think about patient leakage, think about utilization of services, think about total cost of care. Now, total cost of care is a pretty heady metric, but going down a layer, you know, okay, what makes up total cost of care? Cost, risk, quality, access, having all those parameters, you know, within the total cost of care metrics. But the most important point is, once again, delivering this, getting this information together, delivering it the right time to the provider so they can take meaningful actions with the patients that they're seeing. But that's, you know, that's in my experience what I've seen that helps us, you know, in some way get to that sort of nirvana point of gaining consensus on what those outcomes and metrics ought to be.
Thank you, Asif. I think this is indeed very profound. And as I was listening to you and the way you enumerated the guardrails using which other organizations could think of, one, building consensus, and also actually going ahead and contracting for it and delivering an outcomes, gives me enough confidence that yes, the ideas that we are thinking about can indeed be taken to execution. And on this note, Ganesh, I'm coming to you. You have a unique perspective as an advisor to your customers. You have seen, experience both sides of the adoption spectrum. So whether it's the alignment with the future or just plain day-to-day execution. And in many ways, all the questions that we have dealt with so far have touched upon aspects that relate to this dichotomy of here and now versus future. Now, in your experience, how can organizations do both, ensuring that day-to-day operations do not get impacted, and at the same time, we take enough of these ideas to execution?
Sure, Abhishek, thank you. So I think there are five or six things that I have seen our customers do, as well as we do recommend as well. The first and foremost thing is, we have seen large plans or large health systems have a clear segregation in terms of roles, right? The roles like the CAO, CDO tend to, CDO as in chief data officer, tends to focus on the run aspect of it, to making sure that the foundations are right and so on and so forth. And then there are new roles that are evolving, like the chief digital officers, chief analytics officers, and there are some organizations even have chief innovation officers. But however, if you look at the regional plans or regional health systems, many a times these roles are combined, right? Take in the case of Tony, he's the chief digital and information officer, right? But irrespective of the structure, I think the key is to have teams focus both on run as well as transformation separately, so that one doesn't take the precedence over the other, and then you are doing it the right way. That's the first thing in my view. And the second thing we advise to our customers is to have a dual mandate. There is so much of opportunities to get the foundation right, specifically on the engineering side and the data side. And the second thing is keeping the organizations lean, agile, and nimble, so that any savings and funding could be fueled for the transformation opportunity, right? So we talk to our customers across the CXO suite to make sure that there is a dual mandate, right? That's the second aspect of it. The third most important aspect of it is from an overall strategy perspective. I think early on in the process, if they can make decisions on buy versus build, source versus in-house, right? Depending upon the capabilities that they have, depending upon the scale, time to market, I think that's going to help them really well as well, so that they can prioritize their talent in terms of where the talent can be utilized, right? And the fourth important thing is there is so much happening in the health industry, right? Change management is very, very critical and important, not only for their internal organizations, even for the external. As they work with their members and patients, change management is going to be very, very critical, right? So that's a huge aspect of it. Most importantly, when we talk to the customers with the experience taking precedence, trying to have a product IT mindset rather than an application or an enterprise IT mindset, right? Having your teams think of anything and everything that they are doing from a product mindset perspective is really going to be helpful, right? And the other thing I can think of is, many of the times the customers look at digital transformation primarily from a front office perspective, whichever touches the consumers, right? Our view is have a holistic view that cuts across the entire enterprise, whether it is front office, mid office, back office, so you can get the value quickly and get the value for the investments that you have made, right? So that's another thing that we talk to our customers. Finally, once you have a plan, making sure breaking it down into smaller chunk is very, very important, right? Anything you can't measure is going to be very, very difficult. So breaking it to smaller chunks so that it's measurable, iteratable, as well as using some of the latest things like DevOps and other things could really help, right? And finally, one thing I always tell our customers is health industry is unique, regulated, but there's a lot of things that we could learn from other industries as an example, right? If you look at banking, which is our closest cousin, if I can say, they have done online banking really well. They have done interoperability really well, right? And we could probably draw a leaf or two from there. And if you look at some other industry like tech industry, right? They've done phenomenal job of experience, net promoter score, which is north of 70 or 80, depending upon whom you're talking about. So we can draw a leaf or two from there. Finally, the retail and consumer hospitality industry have done a phenomenal job of omni-channel experience, member 360 and so on and so forth, which is the need of the hour in health industry, right? Whether you're looking at a patient 360 or a member 360, or even for that matter, omni-channel experience, right? So these are all the things that we recommend to our customers and see many of our customers do as well, Abhishek.
Superb, superb. In fact, you have created an interesting segue into discussing how can healthcare organizations make the rubber meet the road. And you were talking about this aspect, Ganesh, that hey, organizations need to start thinking of their roadmap in smaller chunks, obviously having a larger, very well articulated vision. And one of these chunks that I see playing out in most healthcare organizations is this question of data. And I'm coming to you, Chris, back again, because this is a question that you have dealt with in depth. And we have seen that, and you have seen that data is core to driving any outcome-focused initiative. And this is what we are discussing today. So in your experience, What will you recommend to organizations who want to leverage the evolution of data technologies, whether it's predictive analytics or AI, to drive outcomes on things such as employee engagement, well-being, or even experience?
Yeah, I just want to, echo David and Tony's comments about us moving into a much more consumer-oriented healthcare environment. I couldn't agree with that more. I think we're heading in that direction, and I'd like to think that there's a day coming where it's as easy to pick a doctor as it is to pick a TV show. I don't think we're quite there yet, but I think the technologies that are driving our ability to choose the TV shows we want to watch can also be driving the way that people consume and think about their healthcare. And I think a couple of people have already alluded to that. We're collecting thousands of data points on 14 million members in our program every day. And those thousands of data points have to get used in a way that brings value back to the individual and to the companies that they're a part of. And I think the goal for us is to do a handful of things with the data. One is to make sure that we're just in the best position to inform people. We have data about doctors, quality level, cost level, et cetera. Can we provide that data back to people in a way that's transparent, as David described earlier, and give them access to information that they wouldn't otherwise have? That's a simple way to use data and make it available to people. I think the second thing is around data personalization. Because I know something about those 14 million members, I know how they're consuming healthcare today, I know what the claims data tells me about them, it gives me the ability to make sure that I'm pushing the right kind of information to them, personalizing their overall experience. When they log into to the Virgin Pulse platform, what do they see first because of where they're at in their own personal healthcare journey? What's the next best action that they should take? I think those data points are incredibly important. The third piece of it, from my perspective, is around activation. How do I actually use data to activate people, to provide the right rewards, incentives, communications to that person to get them to take action on the thing that's most important at this point in their healthcare journey? And I think activation is crucially important. We're reaching out to members in our platform all the time to get them to take the next best step as it relates to dealing with a pre-chronic condition or a chronic condition. We're encouraging them to be on a phone call to help them with weight loss or smoking cessation. All of that's driven by an AI engine that leverages data that we know about them and we know is important to their overall consumption of healthcare. And so I think that's the power of the data when you can use it to inform people, to personalize their experience, to activate them, to take steps that at the end of the day, lower the overall cost of care for them, their family, as well as the employer that they're a part of.
Thank you, Chris. You touched upon a very interesting aspect, which is around activation of experience. And if you remember when I was setting up the context, it was in many ways about, hey, there is an experience interface and there is also this digital plumbing that you need to take care of, which becomes important from the perspective of how experience finally gets delivered. So Tony, I'm coming to you here because being in a healthcare organization, you deal with many healthcare personas, patients being at the center of it, but there are physicians, nurses, administrators, suppliers, all of who kind of orchestrate this whole experience aspect together. Now, how do you design systems that one focuses on experience of each persona so that at the end of the day, the experience gets delivered for the patient?
Sure, but before I go to answering those questions, I wanted to go back to something that, a couple of things that Ganesh said a bit earlier. He was talking about, I think, change management, and that's very important. And pushing the digital and the digital transformation throughout the system. I think, we're all saying that really the digital transformation is a business transformation with digital technologies. I think a lot of us have been saying this for quite a while. And that's why it's important for that business part, whether it's changing processes, thinking of different business lines. It's very important for that to happen because otherwise just giving everybody a phone with a mobile browser on and some web pages, that's not going to be the digital transformation that we need. So I think that's something that a lot of us in our spaces and in roles like such as mine and the others here, we need to continuously repeat. And change management, especially in healthcare, is not the easiest. And I don't know if there's anything to do with regulation. Having spent years and years in the financial world. Back to your question, I think, the way I go about doing that is, first of all, I think you need to understand well your groups and your personas. Who are those people? Who are those roles? And then you need to map their journeys, the user journeys. What do they do? And how do they do it in a complete fashion? I think I talked about earlier about that completeness aspect is very important. And that's where the interesting part happens. When you do that for all the, let's call them personas, as you said, soon enough, the intersection points and these folks are on the same table versus those folks are on the other side of the table, those intersection points and situations become apparent. And those points are important to be considered holistically. Otherwise, the journeys and the experiences will be disconnected. You have to think, who are those personas in that use case? And then of course, from there on to experiences, tools, and technologies required. From an initiative perspective, purely and focus, we did define four major categories of stakeholders, users, whatever you want to call them. First is the consumers, and this is those before a medical encounter. They could be repeat, but they're a consumer. They're looking for, they're evaluating the service. They're evaluating the price, maybe. They're evaluating their entry. Number two, patients. So they are in current care right now. What is their experience, and how do they make that easier? Third is the providers. The medical staff, physicians, nurses. What is their digital experience and technology experience in general, and how could we make that that better? And then fourth is really, no disrespect to them, is the operators and the administrators. Now, clearly, the order that I talked about here, customers, consumers first, consumers first, that reflects a focus and a set of priorities, in terms of time and the timing of the approach. I agree with Ganesh again on the fact that you need to go and address all these, but you have to focus. You can't do everything at once. And so we chose with number one and number two. And this approach, I think it helps a lot. And again, focus maniacally every time you look at that user journey on the needs of that persona and the intersection points. But clearly it's easier to do this, or at least for us, non-medical staff, to define the experiences of the consumers and the patients, because unfortunately we're all finding ourselves in that spot, consuming these experiences. But for the others, like providers and operators and administrators, good old ethnography, so to say, just needs to be employed.
Indeed. And I think you lay out a very important aspect, because designing of any experience platform requires us to deal with all of these personas, their experience metrics, and in many ways, some of the metrics that we keep discussing within the industry continue to evolve, whether it's because of the evolution of the technology that we have handy, and even in terms of the moonshots that we discussed in the earlier part of this discussion that people are shooting for. and each of these personas contribute to and also expect their own set of experiences. And that is why, David, given the context that Tony has just set, you know, you talked about the fact that 15 years ago when you took on the chief experience officer role, it was probably a role created out of thin air. But these days, this role is proliferating. It's pretty influential. Now, having heard what you have what we have discussed so far, what would you lay out as some of the do's and don'ts as these chief customer experience officers need to follow as they build their own vision for the technology-led experience platforms?
Yeah, I may be a little different, you know, in the CX role where I'm a data-driven person and everything I do, and that's not to say all CX folks aren't. You know, when I think of like the do's, I mean, I think it starts there. I think it's about, you know, getting your data organized and having an engagement tech stack that sort of sits on top of that. And today, and Chris touched on this a little bit, you know, it's, you know, how do you have the right rules engines and orchestration or next best action, you know, capabilities underneath it? So you're having the right message at the right time with the right individual based on the, you know, the journeys that Tony talked about. And sometimes we joked about getting provider data, you know, accurate slightly. I mean, I think it starts with the simplicity of things like identity management and, you know, and then it moves up the chain a little bit, you know, and from the engagement perspective, there's just so much data in healthcare. And I often say, you know, it's great and the data is everywhere, but you've got to find a way to put it somewhere to make it actionable. And I think that's where we don't spend enough of our time is making it actionable. So some teams out there with very simple APIs can go grab that data. You know, technologists can grab the data to develop experiences against it. I mean, there's thousands of CPT codes out there. There's so much condition codes, billing codes, logic, you know, claims codes. It's just, and you're trying to connect all this and you're all trying to do it at an individual level, which connects back to this, you know, identity management, you know. And so how do you take all that data, simplify it for the organization so that people can, you know, start to leverage it? In fact, you know, just talking this morning with some folks around prior authorization and, you know, how we build better experiences around prior authorization for folks. And it's kind of like, you know, well, there's so many reasons that people may get a prior authorization, you know, approved or denied. And you know, if you tried to look at every one of them, you'd be sitting there forever building experiences. So how do you put it in some really logical buckets to develop some experiences around? And that data, that, you know, that bringing out of the data isn't always, you know, that relevant. So I'd start there, you know, and then I'd say, you know, my next, you know, probably action would be, or to do would be, you know, make sure you've got the right analytics and data environment to you know, have some smart data science people, you know, really, you know, using that data so that you can make smart decisions about, you know, how you create better experiences, how you drive more value for the consumer, for your organization. You know, you tap into the AI, ML, you know, logics, you know, capabilities that are out there. Build your predictive models, whatever it may be, so you're having the right conversations again with the right people, and you've really got to invest your time in that space and know where your data is, you know, or what's happening in existing experiences. So that would be one. A little bit would be, you know, don't wait for perfection. You know, you'll never get there. Although I would say perfection's got to be, it's got to be perfect in from a quality perspective, and I think that's what becomes so tough is look, you can't be having conversation with people, you know, who maybe die, you know, with that you're not sure if they're diabetic or not, and having a conversation with somebody about diabetes. So, you know, it's got to be the highest quality, but, you know, focus on those use cases that are really going to deliver things for those that you're serving, you know, that's really going to differentiate. And get after those, show value, and keep growing from there as you sort of build out that consumer data platform.
Indeed.
Yeah, I would absolutely say, absolutely, you're absolutely right, David. We have so much data, and there's more to come. All the, for example, wearables. My watch takes my pulse every 2 minutes, and I can now push it into. But where do I store it? Because EMRs are not designed or built to store streaming data, but rather every 6 months or whatever it is, you get your pulse or whatever. So that's one thing. And then what do we do with it? That's absolutely right. That's so.
Indeed. Thanks for your perspectives, because both the explosion of data that we are seeing, and I mean new interfaces through which data is coming in, and as Tony just talked about, I mean, there are so many endpoints through which healthcare related or even personalized data is getting captured, gives individuals as well as organizations very many ideas as regards how to deal with it and what to do with it. And then there is the second aspect. I mean, on one side, we talked about the explosion of data. The other side is this whole dark data that exists within organizations, which is yet to be mined, which could exist in the form of paper data, which could exist in the form of past or stored data, et cetera, which is also required to be brought into the mix of how organizations are evolving. And in many ways, this entire dichotomy or debate about data is empowering both individuals like us, who are consumers of healthcare, as well as organizations who we are part of, to think of, hey, now that we have data and we are building interesting insights, how can we start taking more ownership of delivering those benefits, whether it's for employees or whether for ourselves? And we have started to take some of those decisions ourselves. I mean, as we look at some of the endpoint data that we captured, whether through our Apple Watch or whatever it is. So that's why, Asif, kind of coming to you on this. Now, in many ways, focusing for a moment on the enterprise side, what we have seen in the last few years is that when it comes to large employers, more and more of them have started to indicate taking more ownership of employee benefits, especially healthcare. We are seeing this self-insured plan behavior kind of proliferating in many ways because they believe that they have the data to do it. But the question finally remains, I mean, organizations, large organizations, whether these are retail firms, media or tech firms, do not necessarily have the pedigree or experience in dealing with the health ecosystem that you as a payer have. So whether it's VBC or price transparency, what will be your recommendation to large employers as they leverage technology and data to build something which can truly be called a sustainable healthcare platform for their employees?
Yeah, definitely. And thanks for the question again, Abhishek. I didn't want to jump off a comment that I guess David made about, you know, his role as a CX leader, but being very data driven. And, you know, I'm a bit of the opposite in the sense that, you know, I build data solutions over here, but I always go to the business and say I can build the best data solution, but it won't cause any impact if we don't impact the member experience or the consumer experience. Maybe David and I should switch roles, I guess, over here. So I'm quite comment. But yeah, no, it's a great question. You know, first of all, you know, I want to start off with a guiding principle, you know, for employees. And whatever I'm going to say is not anything surprising or anything, I guess, out of the ordinary. But, you know, as an employer, if I put myself into my client's shoes, we've got to agree on the fact that the employer has a very important role to play, even more so today than, say, you know, a few years ago when the payer was doing most of it under the sun, so to speak. There has to be a partnership between the employer and the payer, you know, over here. And there is a financial reason for that. You know, if you look at financial statements, healthcare costs, you know, and the top three line items when it comes to the P&L expense portion of it. So there is an imperative for this collaboration to happen. Now, that being said, you know, when employers, you know, want to think about, okay, you know, if that's the guiding principle and, you know, as an employer, I want to take more ownership, you know, of managing, you know, sort of engagement within my population, I think there are four or five factors that employers need to consider, in my opinion. The first one is that how do we use our existing technology? If I'm an employer, how do we use our existing technology assets to, in addition to administration of benefits, also try to do things to motivate, engage, and change behavior, you know? because very tactically, you know, an email, if I'm an employee in an organization, an email coming to me from my employer has a much more forceful impact or strong impact than an email coming to me from my peer who I may or may not even know who that peer is. So, you know, those are the practical realities of life and why it's an important aspect for the employer to get involved. That's one thing. The second thing, you know, as they're thinking about, you know, leveraging and utilizing technology to impact the lives of their employees, it's to create an inventory of all the actions, you know, that we can take, you know, and, you know, the actions are, as I said earlier, healthcare is very vast, you know, I mean, you can talk about financial incentives, you can talk about digital experiences, you know, you can talk about benefit design, as does the employer, you know, want to have more of a say in how that benefit design happens. And the reason I mentioned these is all of these have a certain impact, you know, high or low in terms of how employees, you know, get motivated and engaged. So having the employer, you know, think about that, and, you know, and there may be some parts they want to take ownership of, you know, so having that conversation as they're building their technology sort of re-engineering their technology platform would be another good thing to think about. The third thing, you know, is, you know, touched upon earlier, AI and predictive insights. I think there's a great sort of part to play for data and analytics over there. And I've had these conversations multiple times. And here's a specific example I can share, you know, a question that always, and it's an interesting question. You know, we have a lot of information, a lot of data that tells us in an employer population what's going on, you know, who's at what level of risk here, you know, the conditions, you know, the health conditions that they're facing. But what if, you know, there was, you know, predictive modeling approach, and we do that today, companies do that today, that, you know, there's a segment, you know, we identify that are, you know, sort of not showing up, but are those hidden sort of, you know, sort of hidden folk within the population whose health will get much worse over time. So if that segment was identified, you know, the question is, what do we do about that over here? Do we even have interventions in the first place for that hidden segment of the population that, you know, that we'd like to go after? So predictive modeling and proactive insights and thinking about this as part of this overall technology solution is really important, in my opinion. The fourth piece of it is coordination of insights. And this is really important for large employers. I've had these conversations again multiple times, that as a large employer, there may be a situation where I have a PBM, I may have a payer managing my medical benefits, I may have a health and wellness vendor, I may have another entity I'm partnering with, you know, to provide digital experiences. The thing is, all of them are going after the same consumer. Now, as a consumer, you know, I'm not taking off my payer hat and everything and just thinking about very simplistically from a consumer lens, I'm getting bombarded with information from different places. You know, so the question is, are we making the experience simpler or even more difficult, you know, for me as a consumer? So this whole aspect of how do we coordinate, you know, across multiple suppliers, if I may, you know, when you look at it from an employer lens, knowing that, you know, it's at the end of, at the center of it, you know, there is still that employer, that consumer who needs to make the right decisions with their health. And the fifth and final thing I'll say, you know, over here for employers to think about, there was an interesting comment earlier around, you know, we tend to look at a lot of conventional metrics in healthcare, PMPM, cost, no doubt, all of those are important. But things such as productivity, you know, how can you translate, you know, that benefit that a payer may provide into actual metrics that impact, you know, a specific client? You know, same store sales in the retail industry is a very important metric. How can we show that improvement in health status, you know, or healthcare or risk for that matter, leads to an improvement in same store sales for a retail client year over year? You know, and can we go over that? And once again, you know, these are questions that are easy to ask, I guess, you know, from my side, difficult to answer because of a lot of things that were said earlier. Right data, having the, you know, right data, having the right methodology to get to that point. But from my perspective, you know, I just wanted to share a perspective once again, you know, just to summarize it for employees to think about, you know, how do we extend ourselves from administration of benefits to actually implementing programs, you know, that impact, you know, the employee experience. Number two, how do we curate and craft an inventory of interventions and actions, you know, that we can actually employ? And what part does the employer want to take ownership of, what aspects or interventions of the employer wants to take ownership of? Number three, predictive modeling and proactive insights. Number four, coordination of insights and data, you know, from all of these suppliers that an employer, the employer may be engaging with. And then finally, you know, outcomes that really matter, you know, to me as a business, not purely healthcare metrics, but me as a specific employer within a specific industry, you know, what are the metrics that really, really matter to me, and aligning healthcare improvements to the metrics, that financial metrics that matter to me. So But hopefully that makes sense. But you know, as I think about it, you know, it's a really interesting question. And once again, as I always say, there's no silver bullet over here. But these are questions that certainly, you know, we all need to think about.
Thank you, Asif. Indeed, this was very profound. In fact, it's already giving me ideas around what the next wave of this roundtable might look like. So Ganesh, there are a couple of things that I picked up in the copious notes I was taking. One was this aspect around change management. I think that Tony and David both had highlighted. And this whole aspect of productivity, because in many ways, that's what helps give kind of fillip to all the initiatives that we are talking about and how to measure that. Could be other topics that we could explore in the future. But just to wrap up the discussion today, one of the things that Asif talked about was this role of organizations to deal with the ecosystem. And he was speaking more from the perspective of the healthcare ecosystem. So like there are PBMs, there are providers, there are payers, and how organizations have to orchestrate them. In your world, Ganesh, I'm going to focus more on the digital ecosystem, which are like the providers of technology to healthcare. Like these are cloud players, GSIs such as Mindtree, SaaS players, and even startups focused on healthcare who are bringing new and shiny new toys and products for healthcare organizations to dabble in, whether it is in terms of data, whether it's in terms of driving outcomes. There's so many different products and solutions that we are seeing out there in the market. So I would like to hear your thoughts on this evolving ecosystem and how do you think it will be important for not only you as a advisor to clients deal with them, but also in terms of building new consumption models and outcomes for healthcare services.
Sure, absolutely, Abhishek. I think the first and foremost thing is our philosophy, which many of our customers also follow, is the cloud first, insight driven organization, right? When we say cloud, I mean, there are multiple aspects of it, right? Either we are looking at a multi-cloud or you're looking at a hybrid cloud, irrespective of what the strategy is. I think there is a lot of investment that's being done by the hyperscaler specifically, whether it's on the health cloud or the health API. Both of them are very, very critical, right? That's the first aspect. And there is so much that could be done depending upon your strategy, depending upon the investments. I think looking at what's possible and what's available is a good thing. The second thing is SaaS. I would take the example of Salesforce as an example. Though they've started off as a CRM company, the type of acquisitions that they are doing, what we are seeing, they are probably one of those companies who have the ability to play across multiple layers, right? Starting from your system of experience to system of engagement to system of intelligence, right? I look at them as somebody who can wrap around the system of record. You know, if you are a provider, probably you could wrap them around your EMR systems or EHR systems. And if you're a payer, you could wrap them around your CAPS, right? Claims and benefit and so on and so forth. So there is so much that's going on, right? So that's another option you could look at generally. And the third thing is startup is an interesting thing, right? You know, I was talking to somebody and they said that the amount of investments that has come into healthcare, specifically in the startup ecosystem, the last two quarters is greater than that has happened the last 2 years, right? And I see many of our customers, specifically both the plans and providers, have a venture fund themselves who are constantly investing in the startups, right? Either they are incubating something or they are investing in something, right? So these are some of the things that we see. Finally, SI like Mindtree, we are heavily invested in all these areas. When I say heavily invested, what I mean is we are putting significant amount of effort in terms of partnering with them, investing in them in terms of building the capabilities. We essentially can become a glue to our customers, right? Where we are scanning the market all the times in terms of what's happening, what investment is happening across the board, and we can bring in all these best practices as well as a scale to our customers. So that's the way I would sum it, Abhishek.
Interesting. Thank you, Ganesh. In fact, hearing all of you, Chris, Tony, David, Asif, Ganesh, one thing is pretty clear to me. I mean, I play the role of an analyst within healthcare. Keep speaking to people, collect a lot of data, and keep hearing about data and outcomes on a day-to-day basis. In fact, I will go so far as to say that if I could get a sent for each time I hear data and outcome mentioned in a single statement in a week's period of time, I'll probably be able to buy a Bitcoin out of it. But then hearing you today, all of you, and the kind of thought processes that you're laying out, it goes beyond the idea aspect. And I mean, most of what you suggested, Chris, from the perspective of how to drive some of those initiatives, Tony, as you talked about the role of different personas, David talking about the experience elements, and Asif from the perspective of the value-based care. And obviously, Ganesh, you talked about the aspect of implementation and how organizations could think about it. Brings to bear the aspect of how all of these ideas can pragmatically be converted into playbooks and roadmaps. Some of the anecdotes that you shared are already aspects that you've delivered on, and I can easily see how this can play out in the future. So thanks for sharing your perspectives. Ganesh, I'll hand it over to you to kind of share any closing comments that you have about this and take this discussion to closure.
Yeah, thanks, Abhishek. I think it's a great conversation, right? I would probably, Sarah, I don't know how much more time we have. I'm thinking whether I should spend a minute or two on Mindtree or should we directly go into the Q&A for the panelist.
I think you can go ahead, Ganesh, with Mindtree, and then sure. We can spend 5 minutes on Q&A.
Absolutely. All right, thanks. If you could move to the next slide. So essentially, Mindtree as an organization, we are a technology and business consulting organization, right? If you look at 5 business outcomes we generate for our customers, specifically from a healthcare perspective. One, we help our customers accelerate growth. Essentially, what it means is we help our customers acquire either a member or a patient, depending upon the segment you are in, as well as help you with the engagement and retention aspect of it. That's the first one. The second thing, we all spoke about experience, which is a huge aspect in the industry today. We work with our customers in terms of helping them improve, whether it is a member experience or whether it is a clinician experience, or more importantly, the employee experience itself, right? That's the second thing that we do. The third thing is we work with our customers in terms of improving the health outcomes. Essentially, this is where we are looking at population health management, looking at reducing the gaps in care, and so on and so forth. And the fourth is cost is a huge problem in the industry, and we work with our customers in terms of addressing both the admin cost as well as the clinical cost. And finally, we also help our customers. While all these things are important from a transformation perspective, I spoke a little bit about as part of the discussion in terms of making sure your operations both on the IT and business side is lean and agile. So we help our customers in terms of digitizing the operations and keeping it lean, right? So these are all the 5 things that we do with our customers. In essence, if you look at the way we look at both the health plans as well as providers, is we look at this as a supply and demand, right? If you look at the supply aspect of it, we're looking at provider networks and, you know, the providers by and large. And on the demand perspective, you are, you know, looking at members or patients, right? Essentially, the view that we have is we look at this from a perspective of digitizing as much as possible, as well as automating as much as possible, essentially using technology to take away frictions to the extent possible on both sides of the houses, right? Both on the supply side as well as on the demand side. That's what we do. If you go to the next slide, I spoke a little bit about this, but I'm just going to quickly summarize. The view that we have from a digital transformation perspective is we believe we do 4 or 5 things are important, and this is what we do with our customers. The first and foremost thing is look at digital transformation from an overall value chain perspective, right? Whether it is front office, mid office, back office. And of course, as Tony has mentioned as well, while you have a larger strategy, you got to have larger chunk and focus on the one that's going to produce the maximum value. That's number one. The second thing is change management is a very, very huge aspect, both within the organization as well as outside the organization, which could also help improve health disparity, improve the ease of use, and so on and so forth. The third thing is we believe we can bring in a lot of cross-industry experience, right? You don't want to reinvent the problem or the solution, rather take some of the lessons learned, best practices, data models, and frameworks from other industries which have done really well and reuse it in healthcare. The last thing is, for many of our engagements, we bring in consulting-led as well as design thinking approach so that we are able to redefine the problem, work along with our customers in terms of identifying the solutions, co-develop, co-innovate along with our customers, right? So that's what we do with our customers. Thanks, Sarah. Let's move to the Q&A session quickly.
Okay, great. Thanks, Ganesh. I see a few questions have come in. I just want to remind everybody to enter your questions into the question box on your control panel. Any questions we don't get to will be answered via email after the event. So to get us started, we've got our first question from Kunal, and I think this one is directed to Tony. What do you think are the people and leadership skills that are required for a successful digital transformation within healthcare enterprises?
Interesting question. Clearly, somebody who not just understands the technology, how these things work, but has that maniacal focus on experience. Because the worst thing you can do is build these things and make the experience worse. Too many features, it's confusing, they're not coordinated, consumers get stuck in places. So you have that. You have to have that focus on experience. So I, you know, that's why I kind of have two different hats. And you know, in certain meetings I'm the CIO, so I talk about technology. In other meetings I'm the digital guy, the experience guy, you know, and focus just on that. And I basically say I don't care about the technology. This experience is good or not good. So I think that would be. And then clearly an eye to the business and what these things impact, you know, mean for the business. So for example, if I open the front door because the mobile apps and the websites are so good that now that there are a lot more people can get in, can the kind of that processing, the rest of the system can deal with that. therefore, you know, that's a conversation to have. So I would say technology, strong technology, definitely the mindset on experience and digital, but also that aspect of understanding the business and how these things kind of work together.
Perfect. Thanks, Tony. And our next question kind of it's a good follow-up to that. This one comes from Sharon and it's directed to David. The need to becoming customer-centric and driving better experience in the digital era is very clear in the C-suite, but how do you create that urgency broadly throughout the enterprise?
You know, I don't want to say there's got to, you know, look, it's a lot easier when it's declared at the top. and there is a little bit of a declaration, you know. But it, you know, in many ways, it's about, you know, if it may not be the declaration, right, that you're looking for, it's about really, you know, and this is where, you know, even connecting to Tony, you know, the other question about the skill set. I mean, I often think, you know, I feel like you know, the type of skill set is almost like a product-minded person, right? A person that's sitting there at the beginning that's truly thinking about like what's the problem that we're solving. And, you know, and then storytelling, you know, going out, you know, showing maybe some, you know, wins in some smaller ways and really storytelling those wins in much more profound ways back into the organization. You know, I've made some significant headway in places, you know, by just literally, you know, I'll get a complaint and I'll just say, all right, we're just going to deep dive this one and document this one and show this back to the organization and show like why this significantly needs an end-to-end experience. Because, you know, even to the digital aspect, you know, to me, the skill set's got to be omni-channel. Healthcare's, you know, you know, when people deal with healthcare, it's a vulnerable state. And at some point, they likely want to speak to somebody if it's a big issue. and if we can't connect it, it's a challenge. So I almost would say if it's not declarative, like there are ways to be able to, you know, take some of the wins that you're having, storytell that back and be very, you know, and put that in front of people, you know, so that you can get some momentum in some key areas of where, you know, some of the investments are needed. Where we've got some of the pain points and the breakdowns, you know, in the journeys. So,
thanks, David. We have another question coming in. This one's from Tim, and it's directed to you, Asif. What are some of the key risks we should be aware of when leveraging data and new age technologies?
Yeah, good question. You know, it's the way I would look at it is from the perspective of, you know, all the players within the ecosystem, you know, so you can, you know, you've got provider, patient, customer, client, payer, et cetera. So I think, you know, we've got to look at it, you know, from the, when we talk about risk, you know, from the perspective of, you know, what is going to be the impact and experience, you know, to each of these constituents, you know, that make up the ecosystem. And there's some obvious ones in there, you know, a lot of conversation around data privacy, you know, interoperability, what is our leeway, you know, and what's the interplay between interop and privacy, you know, is a question, you know, that I know all of us have to contend with over here. So that would be one of the starting points for me, is to figure out, you know, when we think about risk, you know, what is the risk associated, you know, with you know, each of these constituents that make up the system. The reason I'm mentioning that is because, you know, I 100% agree with all of the panelists over here, you know, in the sense that coordination of insights, creating that ecosystem of data, getting the data to the right, you know, constituent at the right time, it has to be the end goal for us. But at the same time, you know, there are some risks that we need to contend with, which is exactly the question that is being asked now, right now. So if I'm a payer, I'm looking at it from the health plan side, I don't own, you know, the end-to-end experience, I'm a player in the middle, what is my leeway, you know, to get all of that data together? What is my leeway to utilize that data to, because at the end of the day, it's about positive intent, and I try to create a positive experience for the consumer. But what is the leeway do I actually have, you know, to get clickstream data, you know, that a user has submitted on a portal? What can I use that? To what extent can I use that to create an experience over there? So it's a great question. You know, those are the things, you know, that we need to think about, you know. So where I'm going with my, I guess, long-winded statement is, you know, to put a cap on it is, there's a regulatory and privacy aspect of it that we need to think about, number one. Number two, we need to figure out that what's changing as part of interop and, you know, all of those things, you know, what is our ability to do some new things or cut down on the things that we've been doing. Need to keep that in mind. And the third thing, you know, I would say is more on the technology domain side, to make sure that, you know, whatever we're doing with the data, however we're using it, is not fragmented, is part of an overall system. Because the worst case scenario in this is that we may feel that, you know, as a health plan, yep, I can use this data, I've checked everything, I've, you know, checked all the boxes, I'm good to use it over here. So I reach out, use that data to reach out to a consumer, but there's another PBM, you know, or somebody else reaching out to that consumer at the same time. And that's a risk, you know, because at the end of the day, you couldn't do a lot of work to create an experience for the consumer. And when I deliver that experience to the consumer through data, in that same day, the consumer is getting three different messages also. So how do you sort of cater to that, you know, that ecosystem aspect of it, if that makes sense?
Great. Thanks, Asif. I think we're going to have to wrap up the Q&A. If we didn't get to your question, we will address it via email after the event. So that's all the time we have. If you're interested in learning more, our team is ready to help. You can go ahead and send us an email at info@mindtree.com. I'd like to thank our guest speakers, Chris, Tony, David, and Asif, and a special thanks to you, our audience, for spending the last 90 minutes with us. Keep an eye on our social channels and our Mindtree events webpage for upcoming events. Lastly, we'd really appreciate it if you would take a short survey immediately following this session. A window will appear when the webinar ends. Thanks again. Have a great day, and we hope to see you at another event soon. Take care, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you.